19, verse 7. Psalm 19, verse 7. Let's look up on the screen and read it together in unity. One, two, go. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. Amen. By the grace of God, last Sunday I laid some foundations concerning the series of teaching that we're going to be sharing this month. We did some basic definitions. What is a testimony? What is sure testimonies? Praise the name of the Lord. And I believe that those of us who were present will remember. We shared one very vivid testimony concerning the Redeemed Christian Church of God, the mighty work that the Lord is doing, the work that started 63 years ago, which today is still growing like wildfire. We went ahead, to also inform us that today, as of today, the Redeemed Christian Church of God is present in 188 countries of the world. That's amazing, isn't it? We also made the point that, it is possible for people to lack testimonies. Okay? It is possible. And if you are experiencing a draft of testimonies, it is an opportunity for you to search your life. Because the one who has saved us, the one that we are connected with, is a bundle of testimonies himself. When Jesus walked the surface of the earth, everywhere he went, he was full of testimonies. So if you are saved, if you have accepted Jesus as your Lord and personal Savior, and your life is dry of testimonies, then something is wrong. And it calls for a sober reflection. It calls for you to examine yourself thoroughly. And then we summarize three things that we should be doing in order to be able to live a life of testimonies. And I remember I gave us an acronym. Who remembers? Who remembers what the acronym was?
VDV.
VDV. We said the opposite of DVD. Okay. V. What was the first V? What does it stand for?
Value.
Victory.
Oh. Somebody said it's victory. You value your relationship with God. That's the first V. The first V says value your relationship with God. What's the second? What's the D? The D. The D. What does the D stand for? Desire spiritual growth. Desire spiritual growth. And the third V, the second V.
Value the anointing.
Value the anointing on your spiritual leaders. Value the anointing on your spiritual leaders. And by the grace of God, last Thursday, because I told you this is going to be in a series, so we continued. And then we focused on the first thing that you need to do in order to live a life of testimonies. We examine further, our relationship with God. How do we value our relationship? What are we supposed to be doing to value our relationship with God? And I also shared three things, though we only took two of them, and the third one we are going to take today to finish up. So I shared two things that we need to do as a show that we value our relationship with God. Who remembers who was here on Thursday? What was the first thing? Those who were here on Thursday.
To worship him.
Yeah, we said number one thing is that if we value our relationship with God, then we will worship him in spirit and in truth. John chapter 4 verse 24. Now is the time. God is seeking for true worshipers. He said now is the time that those who worship him must do what? Must worship him in spirit and in truth. Beloved, we are in the dying moments now. We are in the end times. Any moment from now, the Lord will come. I want to persuade you. I want to plead with you in the name of the Lord. Don't play games with the Lord. This is not the time to play games. This is not the time to play games with the Lord. Any moment from now. And so, if you value your relationship with God, worship him in spirit and in truth. What was the second thing we shared about on Thursday? The three things that we need to do to show that we value our relationship with God. Number one, we said we worship Him in spirit and in truth. Number two, we said you have to be an incurable soul winner. You have to be an incurable soul because it is a command. He commanded us. I've never seen a true child of a father that will love to disobey the father. As long as the father is not giving instruction contrary to the will of God. You understand? Let alone our heavenly father. And he has commanded us that we should go into all the world and we should make disciples of all creatures. We should preach the word to all creatures. And we shared last Thursday, there are seven powerful testimonies that will follow you. If you make up your mind, you are going to be an incurable soul winner. Sevenfold testimonies. Let's quickly refresh ourselves on those because they are very important. And because majority of us were not here on Thursday. The first thing, when you read Mark chapter 16, verses 15 to 18, that's where those sevenfold testimonies that will follow anybody that makes up their mind that they are going to be incurable soul winner. And in the name of Jesus, because you are part of this movement, you have no choice. Because you are part of the New Christian Church of God, because you are part of Faith Chapel, you have no choice other than to be an incurable soul winner. Can I hear an amen to that?
Amen.
Your amen is not sounding convincing.
Amen.
I decree in the name that is above every other, you are going to be an incurable soul winner.
Amen.
Your life will attract people unto the kingdom.
Amen.
Your testimony will attract people unto the kingdom.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
So we said there are sevenfold testimonies. Number one, salvation. Okay? He said, when we go into the world and preach the gospel to all creatures, what's going to happen? He said, those that believe, there will be salvation. There will be salvation. There will be baptism. He said, those who believe, they should be what? They should be baptized. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. But he that believeth not shall be damned. And then we said there will be signs and wonders. Verse 17. And this sign shall follow them that believe. There will be signs when you go out to win souls. There's going to be what? Signs and wonders. There's going to be signs and wonders. Then there's going to be deliverances because he said, in my name shall they cast out devils. That's a powerful testimony. In the name of the Lord, you do what? You cast out devils. Okay? And then there's going to be what? Holy Ghost baptism. That's number five. There will be divine immunity because he says we shall eat deadly things and they shall not hurt us. Divine immunity. And then there will be divine healing. There will be divine healing. Is there somebody sick here this morning? Is there somebody sick? If you are sick, raise up your hand this morning. Thank God for that. Hallelujah. But we stand together, okay, in agreement, and we release the word of healing to everyone that is sick, every member of a chapel who is sick as we speak now, maybe at home, maybe anywhere, in the name of Jesus. The Bible says in Psalm 107 verse 20, he sent forth his word. His word healed them and delivered them of all their affliction.
Amen.
We sent forth the word of healing to them.
Amen.
We rebuke the spirit of infirmity.
Amen.
We command in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Lord.
In Jesus' mighty name, we pray.
Amen.
Okay, so that's just a refresher of last Sunday and last Thursday. So let's go ahead, because I said we're going to share on three things that we need to be doing in order to show that we value our relationship with God. The third thing is that we must cultivate the habit of giving. We must cultivate the habit of giving. I'm always excited to talk about giving. The reason is that by the grace of God, you know, God, by His grace and His mercies, has moved me to the point that there is nothing that is too much for me to give for the cause of the gospel. Nothing. Nothing is more valuable. Nothing is more valuable. But by the grace of God, the approach that God has asked for us to examine this topic is slightly different this time around. This is the first time that He ministered to me in this different way. Now, the first thing I want to ask us, I want to make it a bit participatory, okay? Because it's a teaching. I'm not preaching now, because it's important that we get certain principles right. What's your understanding of biblical giving? Let's allow one or two people to contribute. What is your understanding of biblical giving or Christian giving? What's your understanding? What do you understand? And I want you to take your thoughts beyond just money, giving money. Yep. I want you to take your thought beyond that. Because it's a lot much more than that. What is your understanding of biblical or Christian giving? One or two people to make contributions. Yes.
Emptying yourself of everything that God has deposited in you.
Okay, Sharon says biblical giving is emptying yourself of everything that God has deposited in you. Emptying yourself of everything that God has deposited in you. Any other insight? What you understand by Christian giving or biblical giving?
Making sacrifices for others. Like making sacrifices in your own life for the sake of another.
Okay. Making sacrifices, of your own life for the sake of others. That's slightly further than where Sharon took us. Excellent. Any more person? One more person? Yes, ma'am. Amen. Amen. So we also, that contribution is saying that beyond our time, our service, okay, God wants to use everything, okay? So it's taking us further and further, okay? So for the sake of time, let me tell you some very, very vital truths about biblical giving and Christian giving. Number one, and the point on making sacrifice goes very, very close to it. It is motivated by unconditional love. Biblical giving, Christian giving, must be based on love. Now, see what we are trying to do when we give, to other brethren, to other people, or we give to the community, we give to nations, we give, it must be predicated on the fact that what we are trying to do actually is trying to imitate God when we give. Because John chapter 3 verse 16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave. There's always a connection between love and giving. There's always a connection. You see, people have visions. People that are people who are sold out to visions. Okay, they give themselves to a cause. They give themselves totally to a cause. Look at Martin Luther King when he lived. Martin Luther King. He gave himself totally to that cause. Why? Because of the passion.
The passion that they had for that cause was driven by love. So the first thing we must understand, the scripture says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. So God showed us an example here. He loves the world. He still loves the world today. And then he gave his best in Jesus Christ. He gave his best in Jesus Christ. Giving, biblical giving, is motivated by the unconditional love. We are doing it in imitation of what God did here. God gave us the best because of his love for us. Romans chapter 8 verse 32. Romans chapter 8 verse 32 says, he spared not his own son. Romans chapter 8 verse 32. He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? See, the confidence that we have as children of God, that everything that we have, God is going to give us, is what? Is because he has already given us his best. So there is nothing else that we can ask from him that he's not going to give us. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
The second truth I want you to note about biblical giving is that it is an expression of faith in God. It is an expression of faith in God. Faith. If you really believe God, if you trust him, then it's going to be easy for you to give for the cause of his work. It is an expression of faith in God. And you know, we have a father of faith recorded for us in the Bible. Who is that? Abraham. Look at what Abraham did. I mean, Abraham was a crony giver. He gave himself, first of all. When God called him out, the Bible says God called him out. I'm going to take you to a place. I'm going to show you. He didn't tell him the place. I'm going to take you to a place. Can you imagine that? And the man packed his family and everything and then began to follow God. What a faith. But much more than that is that the Bible says there was a time that Abraham went to battle. And God moved mightily on his behalf in that battle. And the Bible says when he was coming back, he met with the king of Salem. You know the story very well, eh? And the Bible says he's called Melchizedek. The Bible says he's a priest of God. Abraham decided to tithe everything that he had. He didn't just calculate his increase. He tithed it. That is, he put together everything that he had and he took 10% of it and gave it to the priest. He gave it to the king of Salem. As a show, it takes faith to do that. It takes faith. I'm telling you. It takes faith because even though what the scripture calls for to be given as a tithe is 10% of your increase. Okay, it's 10% of, but he decided to tithe everything that he had and gave 10% of it to Melchizedek. You can read that in Genesis chapter 14, verses 18 to 20. Genesis chapter 14, verses 18 to 20. And Hebrews chapter 7, verse 2. Also, to tell you that Abraham was an incurable giver, God wanted to test him. After keeping this man for about 25 years without a child. Okay, we are not going to count the child of perdition. We are not going to count Ishmael because that was not a child of promise. Suddenly, he visited him and gave him the child of promise in Isaac. And then, as this boy was growing up, suddenly, he asked him to take him for a sacrifice. God asked him, say, this is the covenant child, this is the child of promise, but I want you to take this child for sacrifice. And Abraham did not hold back. No wonder
we are singing today, Abraham's blessings are mine. Abraham's blessings are mine. I am blessed in the morning, I am blessed in the evening. Abraham's blessings are mine. So your giving must be according to faith. Just like Abraham. Abraham was able to be an incurable giver to God because of his faith in God. He believed God. Then the third truth I want you to take note of concerning biblical giving, that it is a choice. It is a choice. It is a choice. See, the way God deals with us as his children, he puts choices before us. Okay? Even salvation is a choice. Okay? He will present the truth before you, and then he will say, choose you this day. Okay? You can choose life, you can choose prosperity, or you can choose otherwise. It is a choice. You must not feel compelled to give. No, 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 no. It must be a choice that you are making, because Genesis chapter 6 verse 3, Genesis chapter 6 verse 3 says, God's spirit will not strive with man. Genesis chapter 6 verse 3. And the Lord said, my spirit shall not always strive with man, for that he also is flesh. Yet his days shall be 120 years. So God is saying here, no, no, no. And that's what I love about the Christian faith. It's not like some other religion that we know, where they will, you know, they will threaten you and, you know, do all sorts of things to make you do what you don't want to do. No, the Christian faith is by choice. It's by choice. The other thing about Christian giving I want you to take note of is that there are different types of it, different structures, different ways. When you look into the Bible, you look from Genesis to Revelation, people gave different things. People gave, you know, there are so many, just like the point was made, so, you can give your time, you can give your service, you know. I mean, to Solomon, it was 1,000 burnt offerings he took to the mountain, and they offered it a burnt offering unto the Lord, and God came down when he smelled the sacrifice. But to David, the way David gave, David was always in the forefront. David's example of giving is what I call the leadership example of giving, because every time David was going to motivate the people to give unto God, first of all, he would have decided what he's giving. And then he will be standing before the people to say, look, we have a work to do. This is what we want to do, but I have already prepared. This is what I'm giving. And then by so doing, by example, he was able to motivate the people to give. That's another very valid truth about Christian giving. Spiritual leaders should give that way. They should give by example. The other truth about giving, Christian biblical giving, is that it should be done freely. It should be done what? Freely. Matthew chapter 10 verse 8. Matthew chapter 10 verse 8. It says, freely ye have received, freely give. Don't be tempted. Don't be tempted to hold God to, how do I put it now? It is true that when we give, okay, when we give, we activate heaven to bless us. You understand? That's another principle. That's why Luke chapter 6 verse 13 says, give and it shall be given unto you. Let me tell you, the easiest way to be rich, to be wealthy, is to live a life of giving. But let your giving, when you are giving to God, don't hold God to ransom on anything. Give God freely. And leave him to do what he's going to do in your life. Do you understand what I'm saying? I know there is a position for seed faith. I know that. Because that's the question that we're going on. Say, Pastor, what about seed faith? Where I can make up my mind that I'm giving certain amount of money, maybe towards a particular cause in the church, and as a result, I'm laying a demand on God. You can do that once in a while, but don't make it a habit.
Are you understanding what I'm saying? Give freely to God. Give because you love Him. Show Him that I'm giving because of the love I have for you. Because you first loved me anyway. Praise the name of the Lord. But I must say to you that before any of your offerings to God can be acceptable, just like we mentioned last Thursday, the first offering that God wants to take from you is yourself, your life. That's the foundation for your giving. Are you getting the point? Romans chapter 12 verse 1. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies as living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto Him. He says, this is your reasonable service. Your giving, if you like, give millions. There are unbelievers who are giving millions to church. It's nothing. He will not buy them salvation. Because at the end of the day, what shall it profit a man to gain the whole world? They will prosper because that is the divine principle. The way to increase is to give. They will prosper. But that will not give them salvation. The greatest miracle that can happen to any man is for Jesus to be in control of your life.
Amen.
It's for Jesus to be in control of your life. So the first offering that God is expecting from you is your life. It is your life that is the first offering. Now, there's a principle that the Lord laid upon my heart to share with you about this giving. Maybe I will move it to Thursday because of our time. I want us to close up on time. This principle is very, very important. You don't want to miss Thursday meeting. This principle, it will change your understanding of biblical giving. I'm going to keep it till Thursday because I don't want to overshoot the time. Let's bow our hearts and talk to the Lord. Let's bow our hearts and talk to the Lord.